while you have discussions about blended learning, there has to be a next step. We have to take our next step and think about implementation of blended learning. What are you actually going to do in your classes in terms of blended experiences? This program will be talking about just that. What are those blended experiences or activities that you can embed in your classrooms? First of all, you have to think about your audience. How familiar are they with blended experiences? What are their backgrounds? What's the level of the course? And what types of activities might you best utilize with that audience? What type of class is it? Is it a large section college class or training forum with satellite discussion groups on the web? Do you have full-time, working students who might only be able to come to class at night or might want to alternate face-to-face and online? Do you have a discipline where the content changes rapidly and maybe you need to use ebooks as opposed to physical books? Do you have a theory class or a writing intensive class where you might have reflective writing on the internet? What is the type of course that you're teaching? All these are areas that blended learning makes an impact. This entire list. If you've got new standards coming in, you can update books quite quickly through supplemental content online. There are many activities for the web, according to my friend Margaret Driscoll at IBM. She says, you can put pre-assessments and post-assessments, pre-work and online communities and discussion on the web. You could bring in coaches and mentors from other places. Chats that you might have with these guest experts or with the instructor. Or just plain old reference material on the web, which most of you are probably doing. How many of you are putting a syllabus on the web or some content, right? Most of you would raise your hands. If I said, how many of you want students to visualize that content? How many of you want hands-on experiences with the content? How many of you want students to reflect on it and think about the quality of that content and do team collaboration? How many of you would want more reflection time through blogging, for instance, through discussion forums, for instance? We'd all be raising our hands. Well, blended learning offers you that opportunity. Here at Indiana, the Kelly School of Business has summer residencies where they blend. And they have students check their passwords and technologies, but also meet instructors and take a class during a one-week summer residency, two summers in a row. At Central Florida, the University of Central Florida, they have students who might be remote and students who are in their large section lecture classes in engineering, in psychology, and other areas, where they send the course out through some kind of a synchronous session. And the student might be listening in with their headsets on and so forth using Tegrity, and they might see the instructor and attend through a virtual format. In other places, you might have video conferencing. Northern Alberta Institute of Technology uses video conferencing to send things off to the remote sites of Alberta, where the students might not be able to drive down to Edmonton for a class. Beijing Normal University decided to use blended learning and fully online learning when SARS hit. George Mason University in the winter of 2010, that terrible winter, when they had Snowmageddon, became open to online and blended learning, right? The SARS epidemic hit China in a big way, and they started alternating their face-to-face and online classes. In Houston last year, in 2008 and 2009, they were hit by hurricanes. Hurricane Ike hit in the September-October 2008, and they did blended learning then. When the volcano erupted in April 2010 in Iceland, people were doing blended learning, teaching their classes from the airports of, Paris and Helsinki and London and Edinburgh. Indiana University, we put headsets on again. I put my little headset on, and I got my little web camera. And I have my camera on my computer, and we do a Breeze meeting or Adobe Connect Pro meeting, right? And I might be in my hotel room all around the world teaching my class or bringing in experts this way into your class session. So that's one way in which you might utilize this kind of technology within your classroom settings. And so you can have your students and interact with them that way. So we have to think about what are we doing with all this technology around us. You know, some places have real-time cases. In Massachusetts, they bring in chief information officers and chief technology officers through the internet. They bring in case writers with real-time cases that they solve from a corporate setting. You might bring in a guest speaker or bring in a video through Breeze. You might bring in that case writer planted in a business. You might have students watch conferences so they can hear from experts out there. You might have students watch expert interviews in psychiatry or psychology or in education. You might have students post their work in YouTube as a way to blend. Their final projects might be posted in YouTube or Wikibooks or a podcast or some other Web 2.0 technology. They might produce something and post it up on the web. They might examine best practices of teachers teaching reading or math or science or counselors or social workers or business execs on the web. Or you might have your students get informed about the class through Twitter or microblogging announcements like David Perry does at the University of Texas at Dallas. Or you might have students record sounds like sociology professors do at SUNY Potsdam. And they record sounds of cities and put them on a map on Google Maps and learn about the cities around the U.S. or around the world this way. And they integrate technology, you blend technology. Or you might do like the dentistry program at Michigan and lectures so students can listen to them again. Or at the University of Illinois, where they post up on the web mock tour packages for people to take. Many ways in which you can blend, and podcasting being one of them, where you might record your content, your guest experts, your students, whomever in your classes. Role play, seances, scenarios, all these things are possible on the web today. So think about ways in which you might alternate your classes through blended learning. You might save on building space. You might not have to build new buildings and save money. Think about ways you might get students to meet before your class starts for social icebreaking on the web, or after it ends to keep them coming back. Think about ways you might stream your class so that students can watch the lectures again or listen to the podcasts again. But keep searching for new ways. Keep on the lookout. Listen to what other people are doing. Think about what you can do. Listen to your colleagues. You know, share with them what you're doing within your classes, right? There's so many things that are possible for you in your classroom settings. What are the skills you want? That might determine what blended learning activities you choose, whether it's visual or auditory. So you want auditory, visual, hands-on? Well, there are podcasts, there's wikis, there's blogs, there's flash animations, there's an assortment or array of things you can do. If they lack reflection skills, there are blog posts. If they lack preparedness for the profession, online cases and scenarios. You know, if you want greater student instructor interaction, Twitter, synchronous sessions and chats. You might want more collaboration. Well, with more collaboration, you might try Google Documents and spreadsheets, Wikibooks, Google Groups, Ning. There's all sorts of collaborative technologies out there. The important thing is that you document what you've done. You reflect on what you've done. You share with other people around you what's possible and what they could do in their classroom settings so that they can be effective, right? You want to have best practices available for everybody out there on the web. Implementation's important. Models of blended learning are important. There are many roads or avenues you can choose. Think thoughtfully, think carefully about where you're going in terms of your activities. Write to me. Let me know what's happening. Write to other people. Tell them what you've been doing. Post your work on the web. Have articles on the web. Listen to what we have to say here at Indiana in our instructional consulting office. It has lots of advice or tips on what you can do. Good luck to you in your online classes and in blending your courses wherever you are in the world, and share with me what you've done. I hope you enjoyed the show.